OK, so hello, everyone. Good afternoon, and thanks for coming to this talk. My name is Ricard. I was born and grown up in Barcelona, but about 10 months ago, I decided to move to London. So I apologize for my rusty English, but I hope you understand it. And if I say something wrong, please bear with me, and you can raise your hand and ask me, like, what did you mean by that, and so on. So as I was introduced, I work at Halo, the taxi company. You might have seen it around the city, or maybe if you are from Dublin or other cities, you might have seen that. I'm a Symfony2 lover and a PHP believer, not a Justin Bieber fan, but I was in this talk this morning about running PHP at the firehose scale, and I still think that PHP is absolutely fine for many big applications, I would say, and this is why I wanted to explain a little bit of all the problems we faced in that company, trying to achieve being able to serve that video game for 8 million daily users. I try to contribute to open source, but unfortunately, I don't have time lately. So if you look at my GitHub profile, 1 year ago, it was more active than it is now. Hopefully, someday, we'll catch up. And if you want to contact me on Twitter or Gmail, those are my details. So why this talk? OK, almost every day, I go to see Hacker News or any random blog post. There are lots of people that I don't know why. They get angry because we are using PHP. And why? I mean, I don't get angry if someone is using Scala or Ruby or Python and they are successful or not. Couldn't care less. I mean, if they are good people and they are successful, fine for them. Otherwise, sorry about that, and that's it. I mean, but unfortunately, the PHP community has lots of haters. Some of them were even contributors in the past, so it's even worse. And also, there are some misconceptions about full-stack frameworks. Some people think that they are an overkill and they consume a lot of memory. That's just not true. It depends on how you configure that. As I said, PHP is absolutely fine for most applications you might want to build. But unfortunately, at some point, and if you have been in a big traffic website, you might discover that PHP is just not enough, or it's not the best solution, or some bits should be replaced for something else. We'll talk about that as well. And as I said, if you have any doubts, Dragon City, 7.5 million daily users, Symfony2. So probably the biggest framework, the most memory-consuming framework, was handling all these users. So I will try to explain how we did some bits and pieces and magic sometimes to do that. So some agenda, of course. We will talk about performance and scalability in general, some profiling and optimization as well. We'll talk a little bit about the storage, because to me, I think most of the times it's not PHP the problem. It's how you store the data and how you access the storage, being it a traditional database or a NoSQL database. And again, Symfony2 is fast enough, seriously. Maybe you don't believe that, but trust me. And there will be also some war stories. I don't know if how many people here are running Symfony2 in production. Can you raise your hand? OK. Don't worry if you are not running Symfony2. I mean, most of the concepts also apply to any PHP project and eventually to any technical website HTTP project, I would say. So some concepts, when we try to scale, we have these concepts, and I will try to explain a little bit about them. So basically, it's about scalability, availability, try to balance your load. And if your database grows a lot, you need to do some sharding. Because in the end, you might potentially have millions of users worldwide, and your application should be running 24/7, 365 days. For instance, in the video game, you had users from America, Asia, Europe, so there were no times where we could shut down the game, so we had to do some interesting tricks. So that was mentioned in the previous talk in that room. When we talk about scalability is a property of a system that is desirable. And it means that if the traffic grows and you need to handle more users and more data, you expect the system to still bear with the load and be able to perform. So there are basically two big ways of achieving that. Well, the first one is not desirable, but it's how we did, well, not me, because I was probably young, but some people in the industry did that. So we had these big servers, and we started adding more memory, more RAM, more disk. And at some point, well, these days in Amazon, you can get instances with 200 gigs of memory, and I don't know how many terabytes of this. But even with that sizes, sometimes it's not enough. So trying to introduce an horizontal approach from the very beginning is much better, because in the end, it's just a matter of adding, So in the end, it's just a matter of adding new servers. Once you have the first couple of them, scaling is just a matter of adding more. It's not that easy as that, but it works pretty well. So I love this picture. It's from Facebook, but on a slightly smaller scale, but it also applied to us. You have users from everywhere. And again, you need to be available all the time. So in case you have any failure, you need to recover fast. And you need to have some mechanisms to detect these failures. Because sometimes in the company, we made this deploy that had an error in some PHP file because we had not tested that part. We killed machines because of the amount of error logs we were sending. We killed machines just for using the network so much because we were not able to test that in the testing environment because 7 million daily users are complicated to reproduce. And again, the most important bit was being able to recover from any failure. So what is load balancing? You probably are running more than one server when you're running a website. It's all about having a device on top of it that is able to distribute the load on several machines behind that. One side effect, which is really important and useful, is that you can make changes in those servers without stopping your app. For instance, if you are still running PHP 5.3 and you want to try PHP 5.5, you can just try it in one of the servers, see if everything works. And in the worst case, you are only losing, let's say, 10% of the users. You are only screwing them, but not all of them. So a side effect of doing load balancing is that you can try with different settings and configurations. Oops, sorry, I missed that one. And that one is the most tricky one. I don't know if some of you have ever had to reshard a database. It's one of the most painful experiences in the world. We had to do it 4 times in Social Point. So this problem happens whenever you have a database or a data set that it just does not fit in one server. You need to split the data into more servers. And you have not thought about that. And if you have not thought about designing your application with that purpose in mind, it can get really tricky. So luckily, you will get there. But again, if you get there, it can be really painful, and you can suffer from that. But it's doable. So yeah, lots of people love, we have 1,000 servers. Let's try to optimize everything, and let's focus on that. And at the very end, the most important thing is to have a business running and to have revenues. And no matter how small we feel like doing business tasks or like features, we need to do that to keep the business running. So instead of focusing on trying to optimize that every single tiny bit, if you don't need that, it's much better to just keep calm, build features, and luckily you will reach a point where you will have millions of users and you will be able to focus on performance and optimizations. Again, remember that this was said by Fabien Potencier once. Micro-optimizations are completely useless. For instance, we all know, or you should know, that, for instance, isSet is like 12 times faster than ArrayKExist or some functions like that. And yeah, it's 12 times faster, but what are we talking about? It's nanoseconds. So unless you're going through that piece of code millions of times every minute, it doesn't affect at all. And on the other hand, just, for instance, upgrading from PHP 5.3 to 5.5 can make your site 40% faster. So try to focus on impacting things and try to do it from time to time and incremental. Don't try to rewrite everything in another language or something like that, because you will probably fail trying to do that. But again, actively prevent risks. Don't just sit there and wait for it to fail. I mean, you need to try to put lots of mechanisms in place to inspect your servers, know how many memory is used, how many CPU is used, how is your disk, if your network is okay or you are still starting to struggle because you have too many connections. And one important thing is you need to try to engage the stakeholders, because they expect that the site will perform exactly the same if you have 1,000 users than you have 10 million users. And you will probably know that it's not like that. So as a recommendation, whenever you see something in half of the capacity, start thinking of a B plan. They will never allow you to do that, but you need to do that without telling them, because the very day you have the problem, you need to react fast, and you need to put in place a new strategy in, let's say, maybe 2 days or hours. So this is why I always recommend to maybe not code everything, but at least have a plan. Because death of success is a terrible thing. I mean, lots of startups fail because they don't get funding or they don't get enough users. But it's even more tragic if you are really successful and you cannot bear the load of your users. This is like a thing you cannot afford, basically. So hands on. Where do we start? Well, it depends on what are you trying to build. But if you have a website or something you are trying to deliver some HTML content, the first thing you need to pay attention to is try to love your front end, and try to reduce the number of requests. If you open Firebook while you are looking Facebook or Twitter or something like that, you will see like thousands of requests being done in the background, and it's just crazy. I mean, you need to try to reduce all of them. And how we can do that? Okay, I guess you know this guy, Luis Cordova, from the Symfony community. Symfony comes bundled with something called Ascetic, which is a library that allows you to like optimize your assets and your JavaScript files. And again, the best thing you can do is try to avoid requests. And how you can do that? You can put some HTTP headers in place to try to, okay, this JavaScript file, we want that to be served the same thing for, like, let's say a day, so we can put some max H header, something like that. Another way to try to reduce requests is if you, sometimes you have little icons in your website to be displayed. There was one technique that was the sprite map that was used and is still used in many places. But depending on the size of your images, sometimes it's even better to do the base64 and put it inside the CSS file. Because this way, you have only one request. OK, the CSS is bigger because you are serving the file being base64 encoded. But you save all the second round trip, which sometimes it can get faster. Again, it's pretty obvious, and it's not a front-end conference, but try to minimize your CSS, your JavaScript files, especially your images. Sometimes people are focused on, oh, my CSS is 20K. Let's try to reduce that to 18K, and then you have 1 megabyte images. So, I mean, it's like it's not comparable. And another thing that, depending again on your application, if you are doing an application here in the UK and all your clients are in UK-based, you will not notice, but in somewhere like SocialPoint, we had users from everywhere in the world. And the network latency is really important, because if you have your servers here in London or in Ireland, it's fine for Europe. But what about some user connecting from the States? It needs to travel the ocean. And from the States to here and here to the States, it's quite OK. But if you have users in Asia, you need to have infrastructure over there, because otherwise, every request takes almost a second or at least 700 milliseconds just to reach from the user to the server. So no matter how much you invest in making the PHP processing faster, you will get killed by the network. So your user experience, the user experience from your users in Asia, will probably be terrible if you don't think this, you don't think about these things properly. So again, some people say that PHP cannot scale. Well, Facebook, Wikipedia, Yahoo, WordPress, Etsy, Jenga is the biggest social gaming company that has been in the Facebook industry. YouPorn, you might probably have heard about that, some of you. It's built on Symfony2, as far as I know. Halo, we still have lots of pieces in our architecture built in PHP, and it works just fine. And let me just tell you about some projects in Spain. You might have heard of them, like Softonic. Imagister was and Privalia were two companies I was working there before SocialPoint. And also 20, I think it's known here. It's a Facebook clone that is really successful over there. It actually has more traffic than Facebook in Spain. So this morning, in the talk about scaling at the Firehose level, Stuart was saying, OK, we can do nice projects in the UK instead of going to the States. And I would say even more, you can do nice projects even in Spain or any other countries, no matter how weird it sounds. Fortunately, people like me end up migrating to here, but that's another story. So why all those companies have been that successful using PHP? Because it's more or less easy. I mean, if you think about PHP, every request just starts everything. It bootstraps everything, and obviously it makes it slower because you have to do the auto-loading, you have to create all your objects, put them in memory, and this takes time if you compare that to the JVM or some other languages. But at the very same time, it makes it really easy to scale because you don't need to think about things being shared. The only thing you need to care about is the sessions eventually, if you use sessions, and of course the database. But scaling is just a matter of adding new servers behind a load balancer or something like that. And this is probably why Facebook was able to scale that fast. And maybe now they are regretting not having rewritten some bits from PHP to another language, but probably PHP was what allowed them to scale. So, I mean, most of the times, the problems are caused by the database. And before considering to move away from PHP, just try to optimize everything and see if PHP is the bottleneck or there are other issues. So again, you'll probably start seeing that as long as your database keeps being popular and more popular, things start to get slow. And there are some techniques that you can use before trying to rewrite everything. And it's basically looking beyond the LAMP concept. Back in the days, basically, it was just some PHP, MySQL database, probably, which is the easier to set up, some Apache server or some Nginx, and a Linux box. You can put something on front of it, like lightweight HTTP servers, or even use a CDN like Akamai to send all those JavaScript files, assets, images. Or even use something called ESI. So ESI is a technique where you are serving a web page, but it's served into like small blocks. And you can cache, for instance, your header and your footer for an hour, but the rest of the page only being cached for 5 seconds, or something like that. And this technique was introduced by Akamai, but Symfony supports that, and it's really easy to use if you're using Varnish on top of it. And you can scale a lot just by adding these clever caching strategies. And again, try to cache all the things using APC, Memcache, or Redis. And if you think about it, I mean, it's a bit crazy to say that, because it's not exactly like that. But if you cache something just for 10 seconds, you only have 6 hits per minute. And if your architect cannot support 6 hits per minute, you are doing something wrong, not PHP. It's not exactly like that, because there's always this cold cache and these problems, and you cannot have everything cached for the very exact same time, because every 10 seconds, you will have problems. But if you're using some TTL with different things being cached for a similar amount of time, it works just fine. And again, don't get crazy. Everybody's these days about NoSQL, or because MySQL does not scale anymore, Oracle is crazy. Don't use PostgreSQL, just use Cassandra or everything. The traditional databases can deal with a lot of data, and they are absolutely fine. But some problems are much better solved with NoSQL databases. So again, read the manual, try to experiment. These days, it's pretty easy to set up a machine in Amazon or some other cloud provider, do your experiments, see if they fit your problem or not, before starting to change everything. Because maybe you will get nothing out of changing everything, but wasting time and eventually introduce new errors in your application. And again, you can find some problems that PHP is not suitable for. And there's nothing wrong by changing some bits to Java, no matter how much we like making jokes out of Java. Java is much faster than PHP, whether we like it or not. And there are other languages these days, like Clojure, Scala, Go, Erlang, that are much better for some problems than PHP. So if we decide to stay with PHP, or at least we will be running PHP for most of our application, we need to try to tune its performance. And opcode cache can do a lot to help us. There's also a trick with Composer. I'll talk a little bit about HHVM, some quick wins, and the most important thing. How many people here are still running PHP 5.3 or 5.2? Well, 5.2, I guess, no way. OK, well, in Halo, some of our servers are still in 5.3, but we did a change a week ago by changing some of the servers to 5.5 without changing a line of code. We saved 40% of the CPU, 50% of the memory. No, well, I'm not sure if 40 of one or 50 the other, but you get my point. And instead of rewriting everything in Java or something, we just make the HTTP request 40% faster. So if you are worried about performance, just try to upgrade PHP. It's the fastest way to do that these days. When you are in 5.5, then you face new problems, but then, you know, at least you save some. So if you are still in 5.3, chances are, and I hope you are doing that, you are using APC. It's our old best friend. I've been in many companies that they did not set up it properly. So please check the settings. Check that stat is set to off, because it improves like 20% or something like that in the request. What this setting does is that once the file is loaded in the cache, it doesn't check in the file system if the file has changed. But I hope you're not deploying with FTP. You are deploying with a proper system. So every time you deploy, you just clear your cache, and that's it. And with that little trick, you can get 20% of performance. If you are using APC to store, let's say, objects or arrays, you can try to introduce this IG binary extension, which is a serializer, which is much faster. And it's optimized to reduce the amount of data that is cached, because it caches it in a different way than the default PHP serializer. check that the shared memory size is what you need. By default, it's set to 32 megabytes. Come on, it's 2014. We can do 128 megabytes and nothing happens. And frameworks like Symfony struggle with only 32 megabytes, so just try to improve that. So increase that, sorry. And check that write lock is set to true. It's by default set to true, but chances are that you were running a previous version of APC and you just upgraded that. Because what can happen is that if you have cold cache issues, the chances are that two HTTP requests are trying to write the same APC bit of memory, and you can have weird issues. So check those settings. And obviously, again, as always, read the documentation. And again, you can use that PHP file to inspect APC in your servers. You can download it in the Pekkle repository. And it gives you, for instance, here, you see how much of your memory is being used. If your memory is fragmented, it's very likely that your memory was not enough, so try to increase that. And here, you will be able to see how effective has your APC been for your application. For instance, here, this is just a standard Symfony2 Hello World. After two or three requests, you will expect something like 95% hits, 97% hits. And all this makes PHP like 7 or 8 times faster than if you were not using any opcode cache. But then, almost a year ago, the Zen guys decided to open source their own opcache that was already in place if you were running Zen server, but it was not available to the public. And from PHP 5.5, it's included in the standard distribution, and you can even try to compile that and run from 5.2, I think, but obviously in 5.3 and 5.4. And the good news is that it has better performance than APC in all the tests. So you may think, OK, it's faster than APC, but what happens if I'm using APC as a user land cache, like memcache or something like that? Well, there was this guy that took those pieces out and created APCU, which is version 4, and it solves the two bits that were missing in opcache, which are user land caching and file upload. So there is a way when you upload a big file to check what percentage of the file is being uploaded. This was done by APC, and now it's done by APCU. And if you are worried, will I be able to do that without having everything crashing? There are lots of companies already using it. I know there are some companies having issues, so don't just upgrade everything and expect it to work. But many chances are that you can just upgrade without touching anything in your code. And again, our good friend Rasmus created a full stack file with CSS, no classes, PHP in one file. But it's really useful to see how opcache is being used. And again, you can see here, if your memory limits are okay, and if APC is working properly. Sorry, opcache is working properly and caching what you expect. You can download it here. So I mentioned there was a trick in Composer. I hope all of you know what is Composer, unless you have been hiding in some cave or something for the last couple of years, I guess now. So the way it loads files, if you look at the PSR0 implementation, or PSR4, which is the latest kind of tweaking, it's pretty slow, because what it does is you can have a namespace being set to eventually 2 or 3 different folders. So what it does is it starts scanning the file system, and it's pretty slow. So when you run Composer, if you add this minus O, which means optimize autoloader, what it does, it creates a class map with all your classes already calculated where they exist. So instead of going through the file system every time, you just know where they are, and there is an array that it says, OK, this class, this full qualified namespace name is in that file, and that's it. And you can get a 15% or something like that performance out of it. And if you were using Symfony2 from the very beginning, you might have seen that there was the APC Universal Class Loader that did the same thing, storing that in APC. But I did some tests, and the performance is exactly the same. And you save storing all this data in APC just by doing this class map thing. So when opcache was released, I started Googling if someone had done some tests with Symfony2, and nobody did, so I did myself. This is the blog post that has more visits in my blog site, so I'm pretty proud of it. And again, I've seen lots of Hello World for Symfony2, some of them running Tweak, the security bundle, lots of annotations. This is not a Hello World. A Hello World is just like that. A controller, return new response, text, that's it. If you are looking at some Hello World benchmarks, and they are not doing something similar to that, they are just doing it wrong. And you cannot evaluate how fast or how slow Symfony is. So these were my results. If you were not using any opcode cache at all, you could have 40 requests per second, which is pretty bad. If you are using APC with the default settings, you will get up to 250. If you add the trick with minus O, as you saw before, it's a pretty small piece of code, so you don't get that much benefit from using that trick. But if you are running a big request, you can imagine that there are lots of classes inside your classes that can get loaded faster. With the stat trick, you can see a slightly bigger impact. And then, if you go up, you can see Zen Optimizer Plus and Zen Optimizer Plus with recommended settings. So we went from 40 requests per second to 340 without doing anything. So before saying that PHP is slow, ensure that you are using the proper settings. And again, I add the X debug comparison because I was in a company and we started seeing some weird issues in production and we discovered that X debug was turned on in production. So the impact is quite significant. So also ensure that X debug is not enabled in production, or if it's enabled for like profiling a little bit of your code, remember to turn it off because otherwise you will see some impact here. Oops, sorry. So you might have seen in the internet lots of people being so excited about HHVM. And if you are following the major open source PHP projects, you will see that Travis has enabled that from the very beginning. And you will see that most of the frameworks and libraries are supported, let's say, 95 to 100%. So it's pretty impressive. I don't think it's production ready. I've never tested that in production. But if you are following the Symfony ecosystem, there's this company called Leap. They are based in Switzerland. And I spoke to Lucas Smith the other day in Sunshine PHP. And he told me that they were releasing the first project fully being served from HHVM. So if it's ready for them. Yeah, sorry. So it's the evolution of hip-hop from Facebook. So 2 or 3 days ago, the Facebook guys, instead of replacing the whole PHP code base, they decided to try to compile PHP to C++. From my point of view, it was a terrible idea, but it was very brave. So it worked for them for, let's say, 2 years, but they decided to change the approach, and they tried to build something similar to the Java virtual machine that you can write your PHP code in it. So it's promising, and eventually, if the results keep being as they are now, and people are starting to get engaged and use that in production, chances are that the next PHP engine would be HHVM. But from my point of view, it's pretty dangerous because a good thing from PHP is that something open source, it's owned by Zen, but they are pretty okay with like being it open source. I'm not sure about HHVM being owned by Facebook. Taking into account how big the internet is and how many sites are running PHP, not sure about that. And also, they are starting to introduce features which are specific for HHVM, like for instance, you know, the type hinting for strings, integers, and things like that. And this can be very dangerous because we might end up with 2 PHP code bases and have a slightly different language. And then we never know what can happen. And even if they are successful and they can run everything, it will never be comparable to compiled languages. I mean, it will be better, but not as fast as Java or Erlang or something. And again, fine-tuning Symfony2. You can still tweak some bits and pieces. The first thing you must do, check that all the bundles you have enabled, you are using them, because, for instance, the standard distribution comes with security bundle, the SwiftMailer bundle, and maybe you are not using that. Just remove them from the bootstrap. SwiftMailer is quite slow, so try to avoid sending emails from your HTTP requests. If you can, as I mentioned, use subrequests with ESI. Depending on how complex your templates are, and if you are using Tweak, you can try to compile the Tweak extension. Depending on how complicated that is, you can get 15 to 20% performance. It's not impressive, but if you're running complex templates, you can get benefit from that. Depending on what are you doing, there is a tag for services that is called cache warmer, and you can try to do that. And again, I've been experimenting with that for Apache. It's not that impressive. I only got 10% of improvement, and they are deprecating that. But if you are still running Symfony 2.3 or something like that, try to do that and see if it can improve your performance as well. What it does is it creates, you know, this routing that it creates all these cache folders and crazy things. So it does the same thing for an HT access file, which is okay. But again, I did not get much performance gain from that, but you can always try. And if you have done that and still you have issues, then it's when you need to start profiling and try to diagnose where are your bottlenecks. And this is where the security forces from Lego come. So you have probably heard of those. How many people here profile their code after every release? Well, one guy over there. Good for you. How often do you profile? Every month? Every 3 months? Never? Probably never. Okay. So basically, in the PHP world, there are basically two big tools. One is Xdebug. If you see Derek around, say him thank you, because he was doing a lightning talk some months ago, and he said, so nobody thanks me for Xdebug anymore and stuff like that. Just give him a hug and say thank you, because he did a brilliant job. And also, the Facebook guys built AsexProf, which is really impressive. I use both whenever I have to profile. And again, even though it may sound crazy, have them installed in live servers, because you can have them locally and you can see some issues locally, but unfortunately, some tragedies, you only see them with live traffic. And if you are running something with millions of users, you can try to replicate that by bootstrapping lots of machines and trying to do the same thing, but it will never be the same. So sometimes you have a problem in production, and the only way to reproduce that is to try to add one of those tools, get some information, and analyze that, because otherwise you will never be able to find it. And again, if you are using Symfony, you know there's this development mode and this production mode with the app dev and app file. I did this comparison with XHProf. So the first one is when you're running Symfony 2 Hello World with development settings. The second one is in production. If you see function calls, 137,000 versus 5,000, this is why I'm saying that some things are much better profiled in production, because as you can see, the amount of function calls and things that are done are completely different. So always be careful with that. Anyway, there is this bundle that adds XHProf to the Symfony profiler, so you can try to do that in development mode, but always bear in mind that in production, things behave completely differently. Okay, one of my favorite topics, the Hello World frameworks, benchmarks. What can I say? Okay, so if your favorite framework is not here, I'm not against Laravel or something like that. I just grabbed that image and I was too lazy to add some more logos. But it's completely insane to compare a Symfony 2 Hello World with Fuel or Kohana, because they are doing completely different things. And at the end, it does not matter how fast is a Hello World. Nobody does Hello Worlds in the real world. We connect to databases, we connect to queue systems, we have our own caching mechanisms. So yeah, I mean, it's fine if Kohana is 20% faster outputting a TXT file, but in the end, it doesn't matter at all, because if you are serving static content, you put some caching, some CDN, and that's it. It doesn't make a big difference. And also, every framework community does the benchmarks, putting the optimal settings for their own framework and the worst settings for the other frameworks most of the times. So always double check that the implementations of the code are what you expect, and don't just blindly trust them. So some people think that writing their own framework is a very good idea. Hope there's nobody here that thinks that, but we can argue afterwards. And also that big frameworks use a lot of memory. Symfony 2 and Zen Framework 1 can run with 32 megabytes of memory limit in PHP, which is pretty decent these days. And if this is really, really, really your problem, and it's too slow for your heavy consuming application, probably PHP is not the solution. I mean, you might try to bootstrap a tiny PHP file doing really minor things, but at some point, PHP will be the bottleneck. So one thing that you can get benefit from is if you're using a framework driven by a big community, something that has been reviewed by thousands of people and being used in several thousands of websites in the world is really much better than the best thing you can do, you and your colleagues. No matter how smart you are, no matter how good you are, it's always better to have some guys in Russia discovering crazy things and like tweaking the application, like if you can see in the Symfony code, than trying to write your own thing. And apart from that, frameworks come with security checking, so if you are scared about XSS or SQL injections or things like that, frameworks get that for you without even worrying. If you're writing your own thing, you need to think about that in every single piece of your application. So again, unless you have some really, really specific problem, and you don't have a really, really specific problem, probably, just grab some framework, experiment with it, It doesn't need to be Symfony. It can be any other big framework, but just use it. Again, chances are that you have seen these tech and power benchmarks. They are pretty crazy. They are comparing PHP with Go or C++ or things like that. I think it's a fine exercise. But if you see the results, they're a bit strange. Sometimes a PHP framework is faster than PHP itself, which is impossible. Sometimes PHP is faster than compiled languages, which is pretty much impossible as well. And again, some of their tests are just, OK, outputting a JSON or outputting a text. And in the end, for real-life application, it doesn't matter because caching balances things. And if you see that, well, probably you cannot see that from the very end, but HHBM is one of the top ones. This test is about running 20 queries because the PHP extensions are really mature. And for instance, in Hello, we are using Go. And one problem we have is that Go as a language is really immature. It only has 3 or 4 years. And when you try to do things like connecting to databases and things like that, there are bugs that have not been discovered yet. Or the memory or the CPU usage is not as optimized as the PHP extensions are. Because if you think about that, how long is it since they built the MySQL extension for PHP? Maybe 10 years, something like that? And thousands or millions even of web pages are using that. So most of the bugs have been discovered already. And other languages still have these issues. So even with that, Symfony is always at the end. And Fabian is aware of that. This is why he hired Julian Pauli, which is sitting back in the backstage. And in the Symfony roadmap, they have plans to try to improve the performance. But again, most of the times, the storage is the most important thing. You can see all these logos. Again, if your favorite database is not here, sorry about that. They cannot fit in one slide or even in 10. Those three here are absolutely fine to scale. Redis, it has its problems, but it can scale really well. If you are using indexing, Solaris really well. And eventually, you can make everything scale, but first, try to analyze your problem, try to read the manuals and see what they do, and find your solution for your job. So one thing sometimes we forget about databases, the traditional ones, are that we have this thing called transactions and ACID. And if you're running a bank application, something that deals with items, something that deals with an e-commerce site, something like that, I think you should probably prefer to do that with a traditional SQL database instead of doing some crazy NoSQL solutions. Because, you know, you get the transaction thing that either it happens or not, and if they fail, they roll back, which is something you cannot do with most NoSQL databases. And you can do things like foreign keys, joins, and one thing that our CEOs love is doing complex reporting queries. If you're using something like Cassandra, you can just not do that. So depending on what you're trying to solve, before jumping to the NoSQL world, also try to tune your databases. And again, you can have millions of records. And if you have some part of your data set that it can fit a NoSQL approach, instead of complicating your architecture from the very beginning and spend lots of time having a proper DevOps team, you can start doing a NoSQL approach using the blob field. I know it's dirty, I know it's a hack, but it worked for us in SocialPoint until we reached the 2 million daily users. So, I mean, instead of complicating your architecture, just keep to the basics. If you are running MySQL, just do that. And when you really, really need the NoSQL approach, just jump to that. But don't do that from the very beginning, because maybe you're wasting a lot of time and your competitors can be faster than you. But again, NoSQL solutions are better for some problems. If you are interested in this kind of technology, there's lots of blog posts about the CAP theorem. It's all about consistency. Consistency means that all the nodes have the same data. Availability is about no matter what's the state of the server, will always get a response. And partition tolerance, it's about being able to have network segmentation. Let's say you have a cluster of 5 machines, and for some reason, one of those gets out of the cluster because of network connectivity or some problem. And there was a theory behind that proved that you can get only 2 of them at the same time. So all the NoSQL systems, all the NoSQL systems try to avoid that, but at some point it's complicated. And if you're running NoSQL, you will see some immaturity, complexity to scale, and again, big data. We're all talking about big data. What is big data? 100 million records is not big data. It's data. And then, if you are wondering which ones to get started with, Redis, Cassandra, React, and Solr work pretty well. And then, another interesting way of scaling your application is try to introduce some queue systems. Even though I have put these four logos in the same slide, they are completely different stories. They are all behind this concept of trying to decouple things. But if you want to introduce one of those, just read the manual very, spend some time reading the manual because they do completely different things. So don't even think that Rabbit and Queue Engine MQ are the same because they are not. But they try to solve problems in a similar approach. Because in the end, if you have heavy HTTP requests, a way to scale is try to delegate as much as possible to batch processes or things that can be run in the background. So for instance, sending emails, if you're doing some external HTTP request for analytics, something like that, image resizing, some stuff that are not critical, all those things don't need to be real time. Effectively, 99% of the things don't need to be real time. So just keep the things that need to be almost real time in the HTTP request, but all of the other ones, just try to put them in a queue system and have them processed by some other language or something. And one side effect is that batch process can be coded in different languages, which is good. So PHP needs friends. Lots of logos here. It's crazy these days, because sometimes it's not the best tool for our needs. So some PHP batch scenarios, I had a lightning talk months ago in PHP London. If you're running 24/7 CLI applications, you have heavy math calculations, massive data processing, high concurrency applications, if you need to do parallel processing with threading, forking, all this sort of stuff, don't use Rasmus Force, use other people's Force to try to solve those problems. And if you're writing DSL, for instance, Ruby is a much better tool, so don't try to do crazy things with PHP, because maybe it will take you a lot of time to achieve that. So look beyond PHP, basically. JavaScript will always be there. Probably most of you have some JavaScript experience. In the server, you might have seen that WhatsApp was being bought by Facebook the other day. It was built in Erlang. Erlang is a fine language. It was developed in the 80s. And now these days, we're trying to talk about concurrency and all this sort of stuff. They solved that in the 80s and without issues. So have a look at those languages. And learning other languages can only make you better. And one thing that's a bit weird is that all these JVM languages are sexy now. I don't know if that's a trend or it has real purpose behind it. Let's see in 5 years how many of those languages still exist, because for sure PHP will still be there. Well, that's my call, maybe. So Symfony 2 is fast enough for what you want to do, basically. And why? OK, maybe it's not the fastest hello world, but such a big framework allows you to test any technology in less than 5 minutes. And writing your own framework has usually higher cost and risk, especially in terms of security. And also, when you're trying to hire people, you need to spend some time trying to teach them why you took these crazy decisions in your framework. Whereas with Symfony, chances are that you can already hire an experienced Symfony 2 developer, or at least have someone with good practices in mind and just put him on board, and he will be productive from the very first day. However, with your own framework, chances are that this is not the case. And one important thing is that Symfony has promised this LTS releases roadmap. So if you're running Symfony 2.3, you know that this will be working until 2017 or something like that. And also, you can get benefit of the bundles. So this was our video game. You can play with it. If you have kids, they will love it. Some numbers here, because of course, it was not only PHP. 7.5 million daily users, almost 300 million users registered. Hundreds and hundreds of millions of records for analytics every day. And of course, lots of databases. We had 32 MySQL sharded databases with master slave replication, some analytics, about 30 Redis instances, some Cassandra clusters. And if you think about Dragon City or any social game, it's one of the worst PHP scenarios because you are hitting these buttons in the game and you are hammering HTTP requests all the time. And we could do that with Symfony 2. So please, again, the whole point of the talk is, if all your team knows PHP, stay with PHP until you really need something else. This is my friend Adam. This was a very happy day. This is a very popular photo in Spain. So now he's getting promoted to the UK something. Very nice engineer, very good guy, really nice guy. And a very happy day because everything was running fine. We even got to the 6 digits here. There's a story here. There was some problem in the game that had some people reloading the game, but we waited until we saw the 100,000 because we wanted to tweet about that, and then we fixed the bug. Don't tell. It's a true story. But it was still Symfony 2. There was some weird issue, but. And these are some of the crazy dragons you can get in the game. I love those. So, just we're wrapping up. I don't know if some of you expected to find this magic silver bullet for Symfony2 to make it faster. It's not about that. It's about the architecture, it's about caching, and it's about that PHP and Symfony2 are being used by millions of people in the world, so they are just fine. And unless you really have the need to choose something else, if all your team knows PHP, just stay with it. And again, if all your team knows Python or Ruby, just do it with those languages. I mean, I'm not saying that PHP is the best tool in the world, but it's not as bad as some people are trying to say these days. And always think about that. PHP is not the best solution, so keep an open-minded for that, because at some point of my career, I thought, oh, I can do everything with PHP. Well, you can, but sometimes it's better to know other languages. And ultimately, if you know other languages, you can ask for more money to the recruiter, so it can only be good. So thank you. And of course, if you have any questions now or afterwards or whatever, just I will be around. Or
thanks very much. Questions from this room? I'm not sure if the other room's got anybody. Can you just give a quick check? Any questions on how to make Symfony 2 do
good? You want
things.
More details about the architecture? We can talk about that afterwards, because maybe now, or now, I mean, I don't know. Whatever. No questions?
You stunned them to silence.
Yeah, that's scary. did you get the point? Please, don't relate. Yeah, yeah, so Fabian is hidden somewhere, so he will come here and do some examinations.
Sure.
Yeah, sure.
So, one, two, test. Okay. So, on a previous PHP conference, we had a guy here talking about how Halo migrated from MySQL over to Cassandra. Mm-hmm. I'm mostly curious, maybe you are not working that much at Halo, it's a matter of time, but while you are there, did you change any modules from PHP over to Java, and why?
Yeah, so from the very beginning, Halo is a bit of hybrid architecture. So most of the HTTP traffic is PHP still. But from the very beginning, there were some bits that were being done in Java because of speed. So for instance, I don't know if all of you know how Halo works. It's a taxi application, so you open the app and you look for a taxi. So that moment is crucial. So you need to have all the taxis in memory that are nearby, and you need to like do a radius. Well, there's a proprietary algorithm, but the concept is that you need to be as fast as possible trying to get the nearest taxis to you, and ultimately also have some fallback drivers, so in case they don't want to pick you or something, or they are busy doing something else, it goes from one taxi to another. So these bits were written in Java from the very beginning. At some point, the architect decided that we should rewrite everything, or most of the architecture, to Go. This is why I was saying. At this moment, we're still running PHP for almost, I would say, 90% of the code base. But very soon, we will start porting some cities to Go. Because, I mean, it's a language that, even though it's compiled, it has this, I would say, middle term, that is not that complicated to jump into it, and you get a lot of performance out of it. However, it's not that mature yet. So as I said before, for PHP, you have libraries for everything. For Go, we had to patch and write some of those from ourselves. And again, coming back to your first bit of the question, from MySQL to Cassandra, having Cassandra in Halo makes a lot of sense, and I'll try to explain why. So Halo runs now in the States, in Europe, and in Asia. So when you have your customer application, chances are that you travel to Japan and you want to have Halo. And chances are that you go to the States and again you want to use Halo. And this data needs to be replicated everywhere. So you can do that with MySQL, but it's really complicated to replicate through data centers. So Cassandra is much better for that. The problem with Cassandra is that you can only query it from IDs or some secondary indexes or things like that, which are a bit different if you think about MySQL. So we had to put Elasticsearch on top of Cassandra to do some queries, for instance, query by name or surname for the customers or things like that. So again, for Halo, for this specific need, moving to Cassandra was a good move, I would say. But we still run MySQL for many things. And we'll probably stay with that for some time. I don't know if that answers your question, you know. I'm not allowed to tell everything, but I guess, you know, yeah. It was not my decision, by the way. I joined the company after the decision was made. I might have done some things different, some things I might have done the same. It's always like that. There's no black and white in technology, as long as it keeps running, of course. Any more questions? OK.
So if I'm sold now on Symfony2 as a highly scalable solution to my rapid PHP solution, where should I first look to get started with Symfony2?
Where you should look to get started? You know, you don't know anything about Symfony2? Okay.
Everybody in the room knows everything already about Symfony2? Oh, I'm on my own here.
Okay, so that's a very interesting question as well. The documentation has been improved a lot, I must say. When I started with Symfony2, it was beta 4 for 2.0, so it was a terrible documentation. But again, the learning curve is a bit steep, so probably I would recommend you, if you were running a company, to hire an expert for a couple of months to speed up the team. Maybe you don't have the budget for that, but if you think about how much it can take for your own developers to pick that up from themselves, taking into account that Symfony is more complicated than just plain raw PHP, maybe it's worth hiring someone and spend some time reading the documentation, going to trainings or things like that. I don't know if that's acceptable, but I would do that if I was the CEO of a company.
Gotcha. Okay.
And yeah. Mm-hmm. But it depends on how smart your team are or how willing to pick up new technologies are or things like that. But I think the same applies to any technology. I mean, we introduced RabbitMQ in Halo. We had some issues. We had to hire a consultant to assess us. So at some point, there are experts for something. They get paid a lot of money, but they can take you out from problems. So I could do that, I guess. Okay.
More questions in the room? Well, then I think you should join me in thanking Richard for his talk. Oh, afterwards.